I'm Beverly Kirk with the Global Health Policy Center here at CSIS, and today I'm talking with Dr. Kent Hill. He is the Senior Vice President for the International Programs Group at World Vision, and we're talking about 50 years of global health, basically the 50th mm-hmm. anniversary of USAID, where you used to work.
That's right.
Thanks so much for being here.
Great to be here.
You were Assistant Administrator for Global Health at USAID, right. and also the Assistant Administrator for Europe and Eurasia. Can you share your perspective on the contributions that USAID was able to make to the health arena during the time of the former Soviet Union
right,
and also
right.
in Eastern Europe?
You know, the first 5 years when I was Assistant Administrator for Europe and Eurasia, 2001 to 2005, about 10% of our money went for health programs. So that was my first exposure to USAID health programs. And you know, we had a huge impact in the former Soviet Union, Eastern Europe. Those places were coming out of a centrally planned, ineffective economies. Mm-hmm. And in places like Albania, Armenia, Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, Georgia, we basically helped revamp their health systems. So that was a huge part of what we did. TB was a huge problem in the prisons in Russia. Mm-hmm. We had a major impact on that. Abortion rates in Eastern Europe and the former Soviet Union were among the highest in the world. Introducing family planning brought those abortion numbers way down. So we had a big impact on Eastern Europe and the former Soviet Union. Then I moved over mm-hmm. and became the Assistant Administrator for Global Health for 5 years, 4 or 5 years. And then I got to do it full time, and I got to spend time in Africa. Spectacular successes in PEPFAR and in the malaria program. Avian influenza hit mm-hmm. on my watch, and we had a team of 10 or 12 people working on that. But I was very proud of the accomplishments we made there. And in child and maternal health, the numbers went down of mortality for under 5. So I think it was great progress during these years.
You mentioned your time there when PEPFAR scaled up considerably. This
right.
was between 2005
right.
and 2009. What role did USAID play in making sure that PEPFAR was a success?
Right. If you look at the percentage of the money that was spent, the great majority of it was spent by USAID. I think it was 2/3 or so. So the challenge for USAID, frankly, was that we were cooperating with leadership that was not within USAID, so we had to really play well together. Mm-hmm. We had to play well with CDC and HHS. So there was a kind of triumvirate, mm-hmm. The AIDS coordinator, ambassador, the head of the Global Health Bureau, and the top person HHS working on these matters. And we would get together and constantly talk about all these things. But the main implementer was, of course, USAID, followed by HHS.
Also, at around the same time, scaling up was the President's Malaria Initiative,
right.
very different from PEPFAR,
right.
but also the same type of initiative.
Right, and what was unusual about that is that you could have introduced something very much like PEPFAR, a kind of standalone, independent entity, like PEPFAR or like the Millennium Challenge Corporation. But we made the case to the administration that you could embed this within USAID, get the same kind of results-oriented program and not have to build an infrastructure around it. They accepted the challenge, the proposal, and we got a terrific lead in Admiral Tim Zimmer, and the results were spectacular like in PEPFAR, and we proved that it could be done within a agency like USAID, where the deputy was from HHS, and interagency group worked on that. So it was a brand new model of doing an initiative led by USAID, but involving lots of other agencies.
And now you're at World Vision,
right.
a faith-based organization. And how important is it that USAID work with organizations such as yourself or with other NGOs?
Right. You know, if you look back on why Global Health Bureau was successful, it's the partnerships. Sometimes they're multilateral. Sometimes it was the big tent involving secular organizations and faith-based organizations. We could not have accomplished what we did on PEPFAR in Africa, where probably half or more of the health help is given out by faith-based organizations. If we had not partnered with them, we couldn't have reached the populations. So you need a big tent mm-hmm. to do this work. You need faith-based organizations and you need non-faith-based organizations. If you don't have any one segment, you're not going to achieve your objectives.
Dr. Kent Hill, thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.